always said years ago, God, if there's ever a war breaks out, I'm showing back to Belfast where I was born. You know, they're not getting me to war. No, I didn't join for war. I didn't want to go. But I thought, well, I've got to go. You know, the taxpayers have been paying my wages for all these years, and okay, they've called my number for once. They've called all our numbers for once.
As the task force steamed south through the tropics, few of those on board thought they were actually going to war.
In his letters, oh, he was really thrilled. He'd said, the social life is fantastic. You know, we're playing darts and there's loads of people, cards and cribbage games. There's lots of deck games going on. And he said in one of his letters, whatever's waiting for us down there, nothing will look so bad if we've still got this happy atmosphere on board ship.
There was a curious air of unreality on the way to Ascension. None of us really thought it would come to a war at that stage. Every day we listened to the BBC World Service about the diplomatic manoeuvres that were going on, and we genuinely believed there would be a diplomatic settlement, and we were merely an extension of that diplomacy.
We had to learn Spanish. Virtually the only stuff that we did learn was things like Manos Arribas and Rindazi, which means hands up and surrender. We didn't think it was much point in learning sort of I surrender or anything like that.
Many of them had adopted a rather belligerent, gung-ho attitude. One of the helicopter pilots told me that he'd never dropped a real depth charge on a live target, and he was quite looking forward to it now. And one of the Harrier pilots said that what Britain needed was a small war like this. It would do morale no end of good.
The Falklands became an armed camp. In their thousands, young conscripts arrived from Argentina.
La primera vez que ingresé al pueblo, veía que todo lo que había.
The first time I went into Port Stanley, I noticed that everything was English. There was practically nothing there to remind me of Argentina. I remember picking up a little nail and it had Made in England written on it.
Clavo, clavito. Y decía Made in England, el clavito. Entonces,
so I started wondering what it all meant. I thought, where am I? What is this? I had been told that we were going to the Malvinas to defend our people. But it turned out that they weren't our people at all. So you had to ask yourself, who were the invaders, them or us?
Malvinas Operation Theater Command, communique number 4, guarantees the continuity of the way of life of the people of the islands, respect for private property, freedom to enter, leave, or remain on the islands. Furthermore, the population is exhorted to continue normally with their activities.
One of the first things they said when they arrived, that nothing would change, and the next things they said was how things had to change. We had to drive on the other side of the road. We had to have passes to go around Stanley. We weren't allowed out of Stanley. And people, of course, thought back to the Second World War and how it must have felt for the French and the Dutch and the countries, you know, in Europe, occupied by the Germans.
Our military presence grew till about 10,000 men surrounded the village, so Port Argentino became almost like a tiny island in a sea of troops. Yet I'm proud to say that throughout our occupation of the Malvinas, there wasn't a single case of rape or attempted rape. There wasn't a single case of assault. There were a few burglaries. Any offenders were court-martialed and sentenced, whether they were conscripts, NCOs, or officers.
The house next door was unoccupied. Our neighbours were in the UK. We had the key of the house. We realised there were a lot of Argentinians banging on the door, knocking. My husband said, well, rather than let them break the door down, I'll go out and give them the key. He was immediately taken by the Argentinians and made to kneel at our front gate. It was a bitterly cold day, Sunday afternoon. For about 20 minutes, over 20 minutes, he was kneeling there in his shirt sleeves with a submachine gun at his back. I never realised just what it was like when you can't sit down. I tried to sit down and I couldn't. I was so tensed up, I was so worried. All I did really was walked to the kitchen and made a cup of coffee and came back. I didn't know that in 20 minutes, half an hour, one can drink so many cups of coffee. And I put on Land of Hope and Glory and opened the windows, and I felt that, knowing my husband's sense of humour, that if he were to die, that if the last thing he heard was that, at least he would die with perhaps a little smile on his face.
Most straightforward possible fashion that
the United States was anxious to avoid a war between two of its closest allies.
The whole conflict seemed to be strange. It seemed to be much less important than it obviously seemed to both sides, because the Falkland Islands by themselves did not seem to be objectively that important, if I may say so, to anyone. And yet, suddenly, they had become the focus of this enormous, intense conflict.
How are you?
Alexander Haig desperately sought a negotiated settlement. On board his peace shuttle was David Gompert.
Well, of course, the most memorable recollection one has about London was Mrs. Thatcher herself and the way she presided over the War Cabinet and spoke for Britain in the negotiations. She would allow others to speak, to address particular aspects of it based on their expertise, but in all cases she would have the final word, and in some cases she would explicitly overrule a senior member of her cabinet.
She was never in any doubt. There may have been those of us who at one moment or another thought, should we just give a little bit more, would it finally end the problems, which we hadn't yet faced, of actually invading from ships in the South Atlantic. But she was totally resolute.
In London, we did not find a very positive disposition toward negotiation. Now, the view there, quite simply, was foreign troops have occupied land over which Her Majesty's government is responsible, and the issue at hand is the removal of the troops, not the negotiation of the conditions after those troops are gone. And that's about all we received by way of encouragement in London.